Michael Jordan preferred flying. When the NBA season ended, he was named Rookie of the Year after averaging more than 28 points a game for the Bulls. Philadelphia's Julius Erving reached another milestone, moving into third place on the all-time scoring list with more than 27,000 points, while Isaiah Thomas of the Detroit Pistons proved he could do it all. Besides averaging more than 20 points a game, the sharp-shooting guard also set a single-season record for assists with 1,123. It was the final season for Dan Issel of the Denver Nuggets. The 36-year-old center retired as professional basketball's fourth all-time leading scorer after more than 15 seasons in the ABA and NBA. For Bernard King of the New York Knicks, the season ended in agony. In a game against Kansas City, King suffered a career-threatening knee injury from which he still hasn't recovered. He was leading the league in scoring at the time with an average of 32.9 points per game. Also in May, the NBA held its inaugural lottery to determine which of the seven non-playoff teams would get the first pick in the draft. Center Patrick Ewing of Georgetown was the most highly touted college player and the clear number one choice.
The second pick in the 1985 NBA draft goes to the Indiana Pacers. The New York Knicks have the first pick.
And with that, Ewing gave instant hope to a beleaguered franchise.
Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
June began with all eyes on Los Angeles, where Kareem led the Lakers through a playoff cakewalk to set up a championship rematch with the Boston Celtics, who upset the Lakers in the 1984 finals. The series began in Boston Garden with a blowout, as Larry Bird and the Celtics stormed past a stunned Lakers squad. Reserve forward Scott Wedman hit all 11 of his shots as Boston took Game 1, 148-114. But the Lakers rebounded to win Game 2 in the Garden, then put on a magic show of their own back home in Los Angeles, slamming the Celtics in Game 3, 136-111. Game 4 was a gut-wrencher. Danny Ainge put Boston up by 2 with a half minute left. But the Lakers came right back to tie it when Magic Johnson converted on an offensive rebound. The Celtics would have one more chance to win it. And with time ticking away, Larry Bird fed Dennis Johnson at the top of the key, and Johnson nailed it to square the series. But the Lakers won Game 5, and the scene shifted back to Boston, where the Celtics had never lost a deciding game in the finals. Laker coach Pat Riley was determined to break that string at the expense of Celtic coach Casey Jones. And Kareem made it happen, ending a Laker drought of 8 straight championship series losses to the Celtics, dating back to 1959. The oldest player in the game at age 38, Kareem was a man possessed, scoring a team-high 29 points to punctuate the record he'd set earlier in the series as the NBA's all-time leading scorer in the playoffs. The final score of Game 6 was 111-100. Kareem was the unanimous choice as most valuable player in the series. And the Los Angeles Lakers were world champions for the spread. Kansas City came storming back to tie it at 3 games apiece after the series had returned to Toronto, where KC catcher Jim Sundberg powered the Royals to the pennant with a bases-loaded triple in the 7th and deciding game. It was Kansas City's good fortune that this was the first year in which the playoffs were increased from 5 games to 7. In the National League playoffs, Los Angeles won the first 2 games, but the Cardinals took the next 2, and St. Louis flipped out when Ozzie Smith batted in Game 5 with the score tied in the bottom of the ninth.
Smith corks one into right down the line. It may go!
It was the first home run of Ozzie Smith's career from the left side of the plate. And back in L.A. for Game 6, the Cards were down by 1 with 2 outs in the ninth and 2 men on when Jack Clark came to bat.
Swing and a long one into left field. Adios, goodbye, and maybe that's a winner. A 3-run homer by Clark, and they may go to the World Series on that one, folks.
And that it did for an all-Missouri affair called the I-70 Series because of the highway that connects St. Louis and Kansas City. A leg injury forced the Cards to play without sensational rookie leadoff man Vince Coleman. But it didn't seem to matter because John Tudor was in top form, winning two games as St. Louis went up 3-1. Once again, KC was counted out by everybody except themselves.
We've got Danny Jackson pitching tomorrow night and against Bob Forsh. We expect Danny to pitch a good ballgame.
Jackson pitched a five-hitter for the win, but the Royals were still down 3-2 when the series returned to Kansas City.
Now we're going home, and we've got our number two starter and our number one starter going for us, so it's been a good series. It's got a chance to get a lot better.
And it did, at least for Royals fans, because in the bottom of the ninth inning of Game 6, pinch hitter Dane Orge cracked a two-run single that gave Kansas City a stunning 2-1 victory. Game 7 was a Royal rampage. Daryl Motley got it going with a two-run homer in the second. And as it turned out, that was all the Royals needed because 21-year-old Brett Saberhagen was superb, winning his second series game to earn the MVP award. When it was all over, the Cards were crushed 11-0, and Kansas City celebrated its first championship in the team's was rewriting football history. The NFL's all-time leading rusher set records this year with 9 straight 1,000-yard seasons and 9 straight 100-yard games. But it was a rookie teammate who made the biggest hit, 308-pound defensive lineman William the Refrigerator Perry, who played some heavy-duty offense as the Bears built the league's best, won the 1985 Heisman Trophy as college football's best player after a season in which he gained 1,786 yards and scored 17 touchdowns. Notre Dame coach Jerry Faust resigned at season's end after losing more games than any other coach in the school's history. Faust had a 5-year record of 30-26-1. Penn State ended the regular season as the only undefeated major college team, and this year became one of only 5 schools with 600 wins in their history. In the NBA, Arco Arena in Sacramento became the new home of the former Kansas City Kings. The Kings left KC after more than a decade, and before that, they were the Cincinnati Royals. Now witness Spud Webb, welcome to Atlanta this year as the shortest player in league history at less than 5'6". Then there's Manute Bol of Washington, another newcomer, and the tallest NBA player ever at over 7'6".
The headlines read, these are the words.